At issue this week, a major shift in Canada's position on the Israel-Hamas war.
/L27 has been adopted.
The UN passed a non-binding resolution calling for a ceasefire in Gaza. Canada voted in favour.
In the face of an unfolding humanitarian catastrophe, we continue to call for a return to humanitarian pauses. We're going to keep participating in urgent international efforts towards a sustainable ceasefire.
But that vote is causing tensions inside the Liberal caucus.
I was very disappointed in the vote at the United Nations.
Is the UN resolution a sign of shifting support for Israel, and will it affect unity in the Liberal caucus? Hey everyone, I'm Rosemary Barton, here to break it all down in person. Chantal Hebert, Andrew Coyne, and Althea Raj. Good to see you all in person. Clearly this was a shift for the government, and I will say that there was a difference for people inside the caucus, Jewish MPs inside the caucus, between the statement the government made with Australia, New Zealand, and us versus the vote in the UN, because they found those to be obviously not complementary policy moves. What did you make of that?
And the statement the foreign minister put out on Twitter afterwards.
Yeah. Yes.
In which they listed all the things that should be listed of Hamas should lay down its arms, Hamas should release the hostages. Hamas is both the cause of this and could end it if it did chose to do so today. So to put it all on Israel is this resolution which was not brought in good faith by people who were trying to mediate it, but was brought by a bunch of countries that have always been hostile to Israel. For Canada to sign on to this, I mean, abstaining from it is one thing, which has been our historic norm, but to suddenly and unannounced suddenly sign on to this thing, I think is a terrible betrayal. I will say, to compound matters, at the same time as the Liberals were doing this on Israel, we had the Conservatives looking like they're going wobbly on Ukraine. This was not a good week for Canada as a constructive international player.
And yes, Chantal.
I have a bit of a different take.
Sure.
There were tensions within caucus.
Yes.
Before that. I believe that if Canada had voted for a resolution like this 3 weeks ago, there would have been resignations from the Liberal caucus. People would have left over it. That didn't happen. I'm not convinced that it's going to happen. And I thought there was a bit of a 1-2 punch here that New Zealand, Australia, Canada, that statement was really meant to signal that they were going to vote the way they voted in the General Assembly at the UN. But only 9 countries supported Israel. Only one of those was the US, the only G7 country that actually supported Israel in the
yes.
General Assembly. Now, normally, I would have expected the President of the United States to reiterate his support for Israel. That is not what happened. The sequence was this vote took place with these countries, including Canada, voting the way they did, and Joe Biden came out and said the current government of Israel is losing international support. It was as if the allies of the U.S. were providing an illustration for how much support Israel is losing internationally. And I do believe that the fact no one has resigned from caucus when they would have 3 weeks ago or a month ago is also a sign that what has been happening in Gaza is making it harder to support the way that the Israel government is conducting that battle.
Yeah.
On Ukraine, I totally agree with Andrew. It was a weird spectacle.
The resignations piece, it definitely was on the table, I think, for some people, according to what I heard, Althea. I don't know that it still is. But I wonder if this is also because there were a lot of people in caucus who were decrying what was happening in Gaza for many weeks and not getting the attention, perhaps, that they wanted from their own party.
I hope there's not any resignation in caucus, because I hope that there is a space for people to disagree and still remain united. I think it would be really sad, just personally speaking, to have MPs decide that because on this issue they can't stay. Because what we're seeing is, outside on the streets, people seem to be getting more and more entrenched in their positions.
Yeah.
The reason the government changed its vote, I believe, is because last time the same vote happened at the UN, they tried to bring forward an amendment, and the amendments need 2/3 in order to pass. And it got the majority, but it didn't get 2/3 to add a condemnation of Hamas in the motion. And this happened again this week. And I think they knew that that was going to happen, and that's why, to Chantal's point, Israel, Australia, New Zealand, and Canada came out in order to kind of add an asterisk to their vote. But how their vote played out several weeks ago was that it seemed like Canada was in favor of allowing the killing of innocent women and children, and they didn't want that to happen. Mm-hmm. And I think those arguments started to get more and more credence. And I think the other thing that happened is that Israel made it difficult for Canada to side with Israel. When you have the ambassador of Israel to the UK come out on TV and say, we do not believe in a two-state solution, sure, there should not be a Palestinian state living next to Israel, that makes it hard for Canada that has a two-state solution to say that, that, you know, we abide by that. And it gives credence to people who do believe that this is a genocide, that Israel wants to wipe Gaza off the map. And so I think that is the reason why the government changed the
But does it mean that Canada cannot help engage with Israel now because it's taken...
But we're not the major player there.
No,
The major player is the U.S. Yes, yes. And what the U.S. needs is pressure that it can bring on the current government of Israel. Let's be serious. There were massive demonstrations in Israel against the Netanyahu government over the past few weeks. So when I watched the Canadian position and the American position, my take isn't that they fell apart, they're apart from each other. It's that they are all putting pressure to try to get a regime change in Jerusalem.
Yeah. And I think we can separate the current government of Israel and its stance on things like the two-state solution from the prosecution of the war against Hamas, on which there can also be reasonable differences of opinion of exactly how it's being prosecuted. But the principle that Israel is not only entitled to but obliged to defend its citizens from this monstrous threat on its border, and that doing so requires taking Hamas out of commission, mm-hmm. and that in doing so and in prosecuting a war, inevitably there will be civilian casualties. People seem to be trying to say that Israel, alone amongst countries on earth, has only the right to defend itself if it doesn't cause any casualties.
I don't think that's
I think that's just remarkably one-sided.
I think that is the way that some will frame it. But others will say that getting rid of Hamas is a worthy goal that Canada supports, but it's also consideration has to be given in how you do that.
Yeah,
if you told everybody to go to the south and you start bombing in the south and there is no place, no safe place for people to live where there is going to be famine and there could be cholera, you know,
name me another country in the prosecution of a war that tells people where it's going to be dropping bombs.
What Joe Biden had to say about the way the war is conducted is literally the Canadian position. Yeah. The only difference is the vote in the UN, but bottom line, in substance, Canada and the U.S. are saying the same thing. The way the war is being conducted is exacting too many civilian casualties that cannot be
Israel should be held to the standards of international law. Everyone reasonably should agree with that. I don't agree they should be held to a different standard unique to Israel, which is what seems to be happening.
The UNGA motion actually just says that. So it doesn't matter because it's just a symbol. It is non-binding. It will mean nothing.
Right. It is certainly not going to change Israel.
What is interesting is all the caveats also that the Liberals went to great lengths to put, some of which are, you know, No Palestinian state with Hamas in the leadership.
Yeah.
Does that even mean then that there will not be a democratic vote? Because you could call Hamas something else, but will the international community be deciding who rules over a free Palestine? We were getting ahead of ourselves, it is interesting how they have tried to couch their position so that they can please as many people as they can please.
But if this is the world concern turning in this direction, as we all seem to agree on at least that point, and Israel is not responsive to that, I just don't know what happens in terms of global pressure.
But there are democratic forces in play in Israel. It's not for us to sit and say Israel, because a specific government is acting, controversial government is acting in one way. That is not Israel in the same way that Premier Legault is not Quebec.
Yeah.
But have you ever seen a foreign policy issue that is so seized Canadian politics, including people on the streets.
Divided people, for sure.
It is in a league of its own.
Yeah. Including people who have no tie to the...
That's right.
It would certainly be the best thing for Israel's war effort to have a different government. There cannot be a less persuasive spokesman for the Israeli cause than Benjamin Netanyahu.
Okay. We're going to leave this topic there. That was easier to do in person, that topic. That's a hard one.
Agree.
When we return... We're